The only way possible to worship is by the Holy Ghost. And the only state of the heart is as the living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, withholding nothing of your heart and your affections, withholding nothing of your passions. And when you do, I'm telling you right now, the living God who is truly here and present will captivate your heart. You'll have an encounter with them. You won't be distracted. You won't have awkward moments. Don't be looking around. And God is so good that He's and long suffering that He's patiently works with us to show us how to do something so simple as to love Him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our strength, with everything that's within us. What we were created to do, the greatest thing we could possibly ever do, the most wonderful encounter, the most glorious expression of life. And without it, you'll be distracted and you'll go after things that don't belong to life. And you'll think that there are desires and needs that you want to fulfill, and really it's just actions and activity of death and destruction. And I pray today that you'll be able to lift up your heart with holy hands unto the living God, washed, redeemed, cleansed by the blood of Jesus, empowered by the Spirit of the living God. Father, looking for someone. He couldn't find anyone, really. So he went into Samaria and thought, I must needs go into Samaria. There is a woman there. She's a Samaritan. Like in the days of Elijah, he couldn't find anyone honorable enough to receive the prophet of the Lord, so he had to go into Zarephath and there find a Phoenician. The history of the Phoenicians is grave. The Phoenicians turned the hearts of God's people away from him to serve Baal and other idols like Chemosh and Moloch and other terrible things that the worst inspirations of demon spirits that have their counterparts today, actually. Maybe their parts more than their counterparts. Don't you let God capture you because He's looking around. Does he have to go to a distant foreign country? Because among His own people, He can't find anyone who will hear the message and the call. He looks and He sees this woman, married 5 times, living with a man who was not her husband. But she had a condition of the heart that was desperate. The condition of the heart of desperate. Seeking. You know, He sought me out and He found me. And in that state, He's caused me to seek His face continually. Listen, I'm going to say it again. It sounds paradoxical. He sought me out and He found me. So that He could place within my heart a desperation to seek His face continually, to seek His presence. There's absolutely nothing more important to the Father than you and I desperately wanting to interact with Him. You know, we struggle to find words to say, music to play. It's really not so much about the chords anyways, it's about the rhythm. We struggle to find a way to begin to express something that would bring honor and glory to His name. But it's all futile. He said, I'm not even interested. This is the Lord. I'm not even interested. He said, the true worshiper will worship me by the Holy Ghost. And I said, okay, Father, I want to learn how to do that then. I didn't go, oh, well, I got that. I got it. Stand back. I understand, I can do that. And I was like, wait. Who can bring praise that's worthy of your name? Who can give thanksgiving that is truly of any value He said, I'm looking for the sincerity and the truth that only a new creation can produce, that only a surrendered heart can bring forth. That somebody who's willing to come and as we're, it's like this. It's like we give ourselves over to the Holy Spirit, and He takes us, and He picks us up kind of like Samuel would have brought in a lamb or a goat, an offering. And the Holy Spirit takes us, and He places upon a very holy altar something that is not made with hands. Something so glorious, so majestic, that you could never imagine it. But it's something that is typified by an offering brought by Samuel, brought by Abraham, brought by anyone of the Old Testament, even brought by Jesus when He was a young man, when He was a young boy. And He takes you and He lays you upon the altar so that now you can begin to live out a life and begin to worship and offer up a sacrifice that is pleasing unto God, that is holy and acceptable. A whole burnt offering unto the Lord. Many people don't want to do this because it's totally spiritual. It's awkward. It's unique. It's different. It looks like Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all gathered together in one place. There was a desperation within their life. They were just in obedience to Christ Jesus to go tarry in Jerusalem until you have an encounter. Because I'm going to pour out the glory of heaven. I'm going to pour out the Holy Spirit and fire. John truly baptized you with water. He immersed you down as you stood there on the banks of the Jordan. He set you down into the river. He set you down into the midst of the water because you came out of all of Jerusalem and Judea and the surrounding areas of Israel under a Holy Ghost conviction that there was an encounter to be had with God, that there was an event that was taking place, a move of God that would bring change to where that once again you could be revived and become the people of God. And they stood upon the banks of Jordan. They came out from all the region round about. And the Lord says, and even as John took you and baptized you down in the water, I'm going to take you. I'm going to baptize you down into the realms of the Holy Ghost. And men have sought to understand these things and trying to reproduce these things. No, you've got to yield yourself completely over to these things. With an obedient heart, God the Holy Ghost comes and begins to take over the way that you think, the way that you feel. Have you felt God lately? He takes over the way that your attitudes and your affections and your emotions and your passions work. They begin to bust loose on the inside of you, out of your belly, out of a Greek word that is defining literally your emotions and your passions. The power and the glory of God sweeps you away. And church hasn't been that. By and large, it hasn't been that. It's been a place where we've tried to do all these things that are man-made under a pressure to approve ourselves among men, to men, to somehow go through some religious action or activity. And Father wants us to push all that aside. Say, Lord, I'm going to take hold of you. I want to know you. I want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. I don't believe that church is supposed to be anything less than a gathering together to be baptized afresh in the Spirit of the living God. And there, when we're willing to do that, signs, wonders, miracles, change of heart, change of activity, change of action. You don't stay where you're at. You don't continue to live on the same posture. Is continue to live on allowing the same corruptible things to go on in your life, the same earthly things to go on in your life, the same earthly desires and passions to go on in your life. No, higher and higher, deeper and deeper, longer and longer, broader and broader. Suddenly begins to, God has found a place within our life to begin to take over so that divine expressions can be seen through us. and with divine expressions of His love and of His joy, of His goodness, of His splendor and of His demeanor. There's also the expressions of Christ Jesus and His ministry to break off the yokes and the afflictions of men, the torments of diseases and demon oppression and affliction. Just want to do it on our own. God doesn't want, must God go to Samaria? Must God go among the foreigners to find those who would drink, who would come to drink? I believe the woman was honest and sincere when she said, evermore give me this water to drink. Evermore. There's something that's available for you, but religion will trap you and keep you from it. If there's anything, when I spend time trying to talk with people about the things of the Spirit that don't know God but are caught in religion, I struggle to tell them and help them understand the giant chasm that exists between religion and relationship, where you're drinking of the water forevermore, where you're drinking of the water that produces within you the flow of divine life, God's life. You can be seated. You know, John was very radical about this. First of all, I'm going to say welcome to everybody. We're happy to have you here. I pray that you find something so radically different than anything that you've ever seen, just simply because somebody in the place has taken a hold of the living God, and that's going to be radically different. And I hope that next week it looks that much more hard, that much more difficult to relate to from a human perspective, from an earthly perspective. From a human perspective, an earthly perspective, the things of heaven are difficult to relate to. Because from a heavenly perspective, you walk on the water. Earthly perspective, you're nuts. From a heavenly perspective, you say to the blind see. From an earthly perspective, you're out of your mind. Huh? From a heavenly spirit perspective, we know the hearts and the thoughts and the intents of people, and be able then out of the realms of the Spirit to prophesy and to speak forth the word of knowledge. Their heart and their heart and thoughts being revealed, they fall down in the midst of us saying, "Julie, God is in this place." That is dramatically different, isn't it? God placed in His church, in the midst of His church, in the midst of His assembly, something that He calls literally, as it were, the very body of Christ, the very body of Jesus Christ, which has its expression only in terms of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit, not in what men do. We become such an entertainment society. Our culture is all about who's the more successful and how much praises we and honor we get from men, and we're taught that from very early preschool, and our grades have a lot to do with it, and being put to the front of the class, so to speak, has a lot to do with damaging our spirit so that we don't know how to yield to God and go with Him, because in His realm it's lowliness and meekness, is servitude, is brokenness, humility. That's who God is. He has nothing to do with the world and the system that you know. He would never vote for all the things we vote for. I promise you. He's proven it. A lot of people live their lives very idealistically and subjectively. They make it up as they go. They figure that it's okay for them to express their opinion. But one day you and I will give an account before the living God, who will judge every man by his deeds and by his works. And you want those deeds and those works to be found as expressions of His word. As expressions of the activities of the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, you're not in good standing. It is all the blood of Jesus, by the blood of Jesus Christ, that's brought us into this place to be in good standing with God, to be able to know how to grow and mature in the gift of holiness that we've been given. Been given a gift. Yes. You could never be holy enough for God. He just gave you the gift of holiness and said, now grow in holiness. Some people want to receive the gift of holiness to go on and be unholy. John devotes himself in the first epistle, especially his first epistle, to the proofs and evidence of those who know God and walk with God. He equates iniquity or lawlessness to sin. He equates all unrighteousness to sin. He makes it unequivocally a description of those who are the children of the devil, the activity of the satanic realm, unequivocally. I'm just now finishing up a rewrite, as it were, just basically, you know, the grammar corrections and whatnot of a commentary on the epistles of John, and we're going to publish them here in the very near future. And they're available on the website. But if you begin to make a study of the epistles of John, first and second and third epistle of John, but especially with an emphasis on the first epistle, you're going to behold a life that you can't live. You're going to behold a life that's like, what? This is strange. Who can do this? Religion will justify it and say, oh, that's me. Religion will step over into deception quicker than anything else. Religion will go into deception quicker than any other candidate on the earth. Self-justifying. Does God have to go to Samaria among the strangers and the foreigners to find someone who would drink? What happens is God's word begins to minister to us. We discover, wait a minute, this is beyond that which is earthly, this is beyond that which is humanly possible, and then we begin to say, Holy Ghost. I see the distinct difference between your life and my life, and I recognize that I can only live this life by you. And now all of a sudden you begin to have a whole nother level of desire to yield to Him, to obey Him, to learn from Him, to be instructed by Him. Listen, last night I got picked up by, when I flew in, I called Lyft, and I got picked up by a young man from China, and his name was Lei. He just said his name was Roger, and I said, what's your name? He said, it's Lei. And I said, well, you know, I've been to China a lot. I love China. I love the People's Republic of China. He says, you like our government? I said, yeah. So there's a lot of things about your government I like better than ours. Now, that'll really make your hair curl, won't it? Spend some time in China. One thing I don't like is how they persecute the believers. I mean, I don't like persecution. They need to have freedom of religion. But you won't be able to access pornography there. If you do, you're going to go to jail. And you can leave your doors unlocked. Because if you commit acts of crime against a fellow citizen, you're going to jail. And then there's going to be some nice little, you know, situation. So it's a dear friend of mine, was a sniper in the army. He moved to Hong Kong. He's because he felt like, well, and he loves the Lord, he's a missionary. He says it's the safest place in the world. It's a place where you can let your kids just run down the street, no worry, no worries, no problems. Because the criminals are justly prosecuted. Law is for the unrighteous. And people, it becomes a restraint on iniquity. You know what I'm saying? Everybody agree with that?
Yes.
It's true. People would think that liberty and freedom is found in anybody being able to do whatever it is they want to do. No, that's not liberty and freedom. That's another realm of tyranny and bondage. Just let everybody do whatever they want to do. You know, I'm just amazed, and I'm going to say a little bit about this just quickly. I'm just amazed at how repulsed everybody acts about the iniquity expressed by one presidential candidate versus another. And we are in a system where we happily murder over 60 million. And of course, China's got even worse statistics. We happily murder 60 million babies. And the numbers are growing. And we're supporting this. And we're sitting around having to, you know, convince ourselves of how that we can support the lesser of two evils. Well, both are evil. It is no such thing as the lesser of two evils. Both are just evil. I want you to understand something. As I was talking to this young man last night, I said, has anyone ever told you about Jesus? He said, who? I like that one. You know, they're not pretending. Jesus. No, I had one guy say just recently, that seems like a familiar name. Very familiar sounding. I said, let me tell you about him. He said, he's a king. He's a king. He's the king of all the universe, all the ages. And he became a servant and a slave to come and redeem you and me from a wrong realm, a wrong government. I said, why did you come to America? He said, because my family is here. I said, any other reasons? He says, the opportunities. I said, okay. So you left one government that was bad to come to another government that is good. It was an opportunity. And there was a provision, a means by which you could come into this new government. I said, well, the same thing goes on in the realms of the spiritual. I said, it's just like you look on the earth today. There's bad governments and there's good governments. And everybody wants, and they got different ideas of what makes them bad and what makes them good. But spiritually, there is the government of God and there is the government of the satanic realm, the government of the demonic, the government of darkness. There's two governments. And all men, all mankind, when they're born into this life, are come in to the government in which the prince and the power of the atmosphere of the air, the god of this world, is an evil tyrant. His name is Satan, and he imposes upon people the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, so that he can make them the enemies of God by their actions and by their deeds. And as a result, I call it, and we call it, and the Bible calls it, a government of hell. The Lord Jesus Christ came for the purpose of redeeming, coming and rescuing us from this government that is ruled by a satanic power called Satan, so that we can come into his kingdom and live under his government and live under his rule. He came to deliver us from the government of hell and bring us into the government of heaven. But what is it that you want to, how is it that you want to live? People, listen, I tell you. Orthodox Jews live more in the government of heaven than most Christians. If we just based it upon deeds and actions. It's not just about that. It's about coming into a place where the Holy Spirit is allowed to take over our lives. Where we don't feel like, oh no, I've just met somebody, I've got to tell them about Jesus, and oh, they got all these obligations. But you've really got all this overflow of life going on. You're in the kingdom of God. You're in the best kingdom. I thought if Christians could get so excited about Jesus as they have of this evil man called Donald Trump, the world would be saved. Demonic is deception. Oh, they're going to do this. That's why revival tarries. That's why the move of God languishes. Because men have put their trust in the arm of flesh. God said, cursed is every man who trusts in the arm of flesh. Somebody said, oh, God raised him up as a Cyrus. Cyrus was raised up by the Lord to deliver Israel out of bondage and bring them back into a place where that they could now have a relationship with the Lord. Such does not even parallel here, or just nonsense. It's just nonsense. Everywhere you turn, religion leads you back into a trap where you're trusting in yourself, or you're trusting in man, or you're doing it your own way. And you're always looking for the wrong proofs and the wrong indicators as to whether or not you're on the right road. Today, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will look at the splendor of heaven. You will look at the splendor of Christ Jesus, and you'll get out of your governmental thing, this hellacious. You get out of your governmental thing that is a bondage, huh? Where you pray and you can't get your prayers heard. Well, I know what that problem is. I know what that problem is. I know what Father did. He came and he sought us out so that we would step into a relationship with him, that whatever we ask him, he will do it. What happens is people justify their bad outcomes and justify their state, change the Bible altogether to justify their state rather than allow the floodlight of heaven to shine upon their soul and be broken before God and say, okay, Lord, correct in my life what needs to be corrected so I can have your results. So I told Lay last night, I said, after we got finished talking about the governments, and he got it, you know, the Lord was talking to him. I said, now, if the things that are described in the Bible do not have proofs that validate it, then it's fiction. Because he was raised atheist. He wasn't a Buddhist. Was nothing. He was raised atheist. I said, but if these things are provable, if they're reproducible, if what God said in his word happens in your life, then guess what? You've got proofs that what God has said here is true. And so then I began to describe to him how over 200 million people in his nation of China have experiences, over 200 million out of the 1.4 billion, over 200 million, have stepped in to this wonderful place where they've been transferred out of the kingdom of men into the kingdom of God, out of the government of men into the government of God, where Satan no longer rules, but Christ Jesus rules, where we've been begotten of God and Satan can't touch us. I love that verse of scripture in 1 John 5:18. It's a blessing to me. Some people are threatened by it. I'm empowered by it. Said, we know that everyone who's born of God doesn't sin. He keeps himself, and Satan can't touch him. The wicked one can't touch him. And I especially like that the wicked one can't touch me. You like that one? Yes. I especially like that. I love how Jesus said in Luke, he said this in Luke chapter 10 and verse 19. First of all, in verse 18, you know, he said, I saw Satan cast to the ground as lightning when he tried to rebel against God and overthrow God. And he said, I give you authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing can by any means hurt you. I really like that. No power of Satan can be imposed upon you. Some people really like that when it comes to sickness and disease, and if somebody's going to steal from them or rob them or threaten them, or, you know, when it comes to the areas of provision and protection, you know. But I like it in every dimension. I like it especially the fact that when I breathe out my last breath, Satan can't come claim me. I like it very specifically about that. The wicked one has no power over me, no authority over me. He cannot touch me. Now, this is what Jesus said. If you don't believe what he said, you'll never have the faith to live what he has provided. Faith comes by hearing the word. If you do not agree with God, the fundamental foundation of what faith is found in Genesis when the Lord said, and it counted unto him for righteousness because he believed God. The Hebrew word is amen there, is which the word which we use and say amen, amen. And when we say amen, we're saying I agree. So there's the foundation of faith. There's the foundation. That coupled, I agree with understanding that you trust God absolutely. You agree with him and you trust him. I've had a lot of people say that they agree with me, and into a single thing I said, They weren't willing to obey. They weren't willing to trust. They weren't willing to God. They stood there, and of course, many people have come to the altar that God has made for us at Calvary, at Christ Jesus, provided for us with his own blood and his own sacrifice, and they've agreed with God, but they've never gone on and trusted God, and they've never obeyed God. And they've been willing to live their own life instead of God's life. God has called you and I and privileged you and I to live his life, not our life. And somebody says, oh, that's a struggle, that's a hardship, oh, what obligation? No. Just take a look at his life and you're going to say, wow, this is a whole lot better life than I've been living. I mean, just think about it. What deception there would be in a person's life to actually have an opportunity to live God's life and they think that their own personal life is better somehow. God is challenging you. He's calling you. He loves you. He's pleading with you. Jesus is standing at the door of your heart and he's banging on it and he says, I want you to live my life. He says, if you lose your life, you can have my life. But if you hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. You're going to lose your life. It's going to be destroyed forever. Because the reality of it is Satan is a rebel. He's a tyrant. And unless you come run into the ark of safety, which is in the life of Christ Jesus, you're going to be taken out by him and you're going to die believing that you're right and wake up in eternity without God. And nothing can be more damaging and nothing can be more terrible and horrifying than to wake up in an eternity without God. Hear me.
Yes.
Listen. True. God's description of an eternity without him is the most horrific and terrifying thing. Because somebody says, well, is God threatening us? No. He's given us an opportunity to provide a way of escape. It's just a consequence. The judgment's already been passed. It's not like somehow it's going to be a reconsideration. God has already passed the judgment on death that it's destroyed, that it's removed from out of the land of the living. And it's an eternal death. And John describes that death as the second death. When those who were not part of the first resurrection, who did not die in the Lord Jesus Christ, who were unwilling to live his life, who were unwilling to live under his government, who was unwilling to live under his rule, they are raised up again after 1,000 years. It's the second resurrection, it's the judgment of the unrighteous, and they stand before the Lord, and they're judged because out of the books of life, they're judged, and then they are cast into a place called the lake of fire, a place where Satan and every living being who wanted to follow him and wanted his ways will find their end. This is true. Somebody said, I don't believe it. Well, then you're gambling with your life. And, you know, your bottom line of it is you're really putting a lot of faith in your wisdom and your insight and what you believe is right and what you believe is wrong. So people say this, all this is the argument. Oh, if God is such a God of love, he would never allow anyone to go to such a place, right? Well, if God allowed sinners and God allowed that which continues to go on, people who do not want to be under his government, on into the kingdom, then heaven would become hell overnight. And there'll never be a distinction between light and darkness, life and death. Never. So people want something that is a complete falsehood. It's an act of pride and rebellion that says, no, God, I'm not doing it your way. I want you to do it my way. And what God has done is he's provided for us not some kind of horrific life, not some kind of obligatory life. He's provided for us an abundant life. He's provided for us true life. Life, the life that he has, the life of love, the life of blessing, the life of peace, the life of goodness, the life where there is no need to lock your doors. They're like where there is no sorrow, where there is no crying, where there is no tear, where there is no, murder and destruction and men hating other men and the strife and the envy and all that you live in. It's hell. And people go to by their own choices. Every day. They decide to go with what they think and whatever trend or whatever emotional, situation they find themselves in, that's how they decide to live. God says, no, I want to bring you into my kingdom and I want to give you my Holy Spirit to rule over your spirit, to show you how to choose life and refuse death. What's so wrong with that? Somebody taught you how to not walk across I-5. I was driving somewhere up north, and I saw some people trying to cross I-5. I said, somebody hadn't talked to them yet. They didn't get the memo. You don't usually survive. It looks like you can make it, but I'm going to tell you right now, you just ain't going to work. From the time early in life, you're taught how to do things that won't result in you getting hurt, and much worse, killed. And you're very happy that that happened. People taught you how to eat right. Somebody taught you how to eat with a fork. If we went out to lunch with you, you wouldn't be putting your face down in the plate, eating like a dog. Or just reach it in with your hands and shove it in your mouth. If I go to places where people, they eat with their hands and they just shove it in their mouth, and it's cultural to get it all over your face. To us, that's gross. To them, it's like you're enjoying it. And you're out, you and I are out of place in that table, at that table. Because there's nothing on our face. Because that's gross to us. And we gave ourselves to being taught these. Maybe you didn't give yourself, praise God. There was a parent who loved you enough to force you to act right. Get over here, I'm gonna spank. Get over here. Slap your hand. Tell you no. Joshua, when he was born, I said, well, we're not gonna spank him. We're just going to talk to his little spirit, you know, by the Holy Ghost. And we're going to see him obey God that way, you know. And right, I had this great plan. And, you know, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, and the rod drives it far from it. And I said, well, the Holy Ghost will drive it far from him. But my dad came into the kitchen one day, and he saw Joshua trying to imitate mom and turn on the stove. And my dad said, you've been going to have to correct that boy or he's going to kill all of us. And it's true. It's true. Letting him just do whatever he wants to do and trying to do it my own way is going to result in his not only his destruction, but everybody's in the house. So I talked to his little spirit, and his little spirit didn't respond properly. He didn't get it. But you know what really rang true? The knife handle, butter knife handle across the knuckle. It rang true. It's like, ah-ha! He never went for that knob ever again. Praise God. I mean, I tried to talk it through, sense into him, but he just, you know, it didn't register. I had to say it in a different way. And God says he's chasing us, instructing us, not for his own good, but for our own good. And then we want to just go ahead and be stubborn and defiant, say, I don't believe it that way. I don't agree with that. People, Father, at great expense to himself, gave to us his written word. So I said, men wrote that. Yes, they did, but they were a unique kind of men. They were holy men, anointed with the Holy Ghost, to speak by the Spirit of the Lord. And as soon as you begin to step over into that realm of heaven, you begin to understand, wow, this is an amazing realm. And then they had it on a level to where what they were actually saying was the dictates of God. And some actually not only were like Jeremiah, who the Lord said, I put my words in your mouth, but they actually got to behold the Lord and listen to him. And hear and take, as it were, a dictate from his own mouth. But whether he's put his word in our mouth or whether we've heard it with our ears from his mouth, it really is the same. And he says, this is the way of life. Walk in it. And it's not like he's trying to get us to do some kind of life that is terrible, some offensive kind of life, some weird cultic kind of life. He's trying to get us to do life. He's trying to get us to do abundant life. He's trying to get us to do life that endures forever. He's trying to get us to do life that's full of love. He's trying to get us to do life that's full of blessing, that does no ill against its neighbor, that does no evil. A kind of life that doesn't harbor unforgiveness, that is just so full of love that just forgives right, left, and center. A life full of mercy. A life so full of His presence that there's just peace. It's just no matter what kind of war and struggle and shame and sorrow is going on, you and a fellowship and relationship with God, this is an abundant life. Abundant life is the life of God. He's inviting everybody, come on. And the people wouldn't listen, so he had to go to Samaria to find the stranger. See if a stranger would like to drink. Evermore, give me this water to drink. Father's waiting for you to say such a thing. Everything about your life has to change that you don't fully agree with. I fully agree with it. I fully agree. I have no confidence in the arm of flesh. Be giddy with myself. I have no value or place, no value in the opinions of men, especially my own. Very few men agree with that for themselves. Oh, they agree about that for everybody else, you know. I'm not going with your opinion. But the pride of life and the haughtiness of a demonic realm ruled by Satan, that government imposes upon men the pride of life that makes them rebellious and arrogant and self-centered and stubborn and hateful and impossible to live with. The Holy Ghost come teach us how to be the easiest people to live with. So full of love, so full of mercy, so full of forgiveness, so full of generosity. Servitude, just servitude. What can I get you? I want to serve you. How can I bless you? With a big smile on her face. Hug, huh? That's better than living with a dog. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
That's about where most people have found unconditional kind of love. With a dog. I got my dog. Where's my dog? I need some comfort. Where's my dog? I'm going to tell you right now, God has made us to live a higher form of love and generosity than a dog. And it's rarely seen upon the planet. You need to come and drink. You need to come and drink. So that out of your belly and out of your life will be a wellspring springing the very life of God. Jesus said, come learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. The Lord tells us, come, I'll teach you how to be a servant. We think, wait, how does that go anywhere? We like the boastful and the arrogant and the narcissistic personality. Kingdom of darkness. Personified Satan. Try to live with that. Are you listening to me? The kingdom of God is totally opposite. It's full of the meek and the lowly, the broken and the contrite. The meek will inherit the earth. God says so. That's the way it works. Because you may be able to destroy this body, but you can't destroy what's in this body. You can't destroy this life. Fear not him that is able to destroy your body. But fear him who is able to destroy your body and your whole being in hell. That's what Jesus said. Disagree with him? Then you've just exalted your insight and your opinion above God Almighty incarnate into flesh. That's all. And if you want to go with that, everybody gets the choice. The reality of it is men shut in darkness under the shadow of death. And suddenly light sprang up. Because the Lord was not willing to leave men in their darkness. And you would think that everybody gets excited. The light has sprung up. God has showed forth his life and his light. And he says, here I am. Here is the way. Walk ye in it. But men love darkness rather than light because they love sin. They love their iniquity. They love their choices. You're going to tell me that God is going to send me to hell for acting like the devil? Yes. You mean you're going to tell me that God is going to send me to hell for agreeing To be a rebel against his kingdom and his way? Yes. Your end will be the same as those in the days of Noah. And look at how they perverted the earth and corrupted the earth in 1,565 years. Your end will be the same as those who were destroyed in Sodom and Gomorrah as a witness. Yes. Oh, well, God just loves everybody and all the lifestyles. God so loves the world that he made a way for us to escape the damnation and the destruction and the kingdom of darkness and the tyranny and the deception of sin and iniquity. And Peter said, listen, they having eyes full of adultery do not know how to cease from sin. And here we are in this day and this time where people have given themselves over to the kingdom of this world, and they visit every once in a while and consider for a moment what God has to say about his kingdom. The door is open, dear people, that we may step into the kingdom of life and light and be ruled by the sovereign almighty God. Well, I don't want anybody ruling me. You're being ruled. He says, I don't want anyone ruling me. If you cut me, I bleed red, white, and blue. Really? I love my freedom. What freedoms? Well, I praise God for the freedoms that we do have. We have freedoms. We have order. But what freedoms when it comes really down to that which God has made available to us in terms of he that the Son sets free is free indeed. Free from what? Free from the darkness, free from the tyrannical reign of the satanic, free from all this realm of hate and strife and division and lies and deception and murder and cheating and broken relationships. I look into people's eyes and I look at the history of their broken relationships. Look in their eyes, I see the history of their hurt, their unfulfillment, the fact that they're lonely. They got people all around them. Their insecurity is so sad. That's a terrible realm to have to live in. Papa wants to come over here and fill you up so that you'll be complete. Huh? So you just like, yeah, you be like the crippled man sitting by the gate called Beautiful. Suddenly Jesus comes and touches you and you like leaping and dancing and praising God. Somebody said, what happened to you? Hey, Jesus touched me. You're not under obligation to testify or to witness of him. You filled up to the full. You in the kingdom, you've been liberated. You've got a new insight. You're not constantly trying to figure out what you're going to tell people based upon what you think they believe and the culture that they're bound to. You're liberated from all that mental mess. It is free to be who God has made us to be in him, to live out his life. I pray in the name of Jesus that everybody in this place will recognize if you call upon the name of the Lord, you can be translated out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the dear Son. That's what Paul said in Colossians chapter 1:13. And there, we're developed by God in the gift of holiness that he gives us. We're developed by God in the gift of righteousness that he gives us. We're developed by God in the realms of faith and the authority of heaven and the power of heaven, so that sickness and disease will not be able to stand and resist us, so that we speak to the blind, they see, the deaf, they hear, the crippled, they walk. Those who are tormented by cancer, terrible demon spirit. Those who are tormented by depression, terrible afflicting demon spirit. Somebody said, oh, it's an imbalance in my chemistry. Do you even know what that is? No. You don't. And neither does the person who told you. All they did was repeat something they read out of a book. And the person who wrote the book didn't have a clue either. He just had to come up with a theory to kind of, you know, tied things over until somebody knows some more. Can you hear what I'm saying?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. And through that investigation, men found a way
to alter behavior? Sure. But it's still just a farce. God's come and brought the cure. His name is Jesus. What plagues you today? God's got the cure for you. What plagues you? What plagues you today? What plagues you today? God's got the cure. Why live in bondage anymore? Why live in the prison anymore? He's here to liberate you. He's here to set you free from whatever it is, sickness, disease, sin, addiction, depression, whatever it is. Fear, whatever torment, whatever fear. He's here to set you free so you can come over here and be taught how to live his life. All you have to do is respond to him with your whole heart. Say, okay, Lord, I'm done with me and I want to change completely. Change me. And he gives to us, he grants to us the privilege of total change. Just instantaneously. But then we're going to have, then some of the big challenges take place. Because now we're going to have to learn how to walk in his will instead of our will. We're going to have to obey his voice instead of our voice. We're going to have to learn how to go with his thinking instead of our thinking. And praise God, we have his word, which is truth. And we have his Holy Spirit, which is truth. And that truth is the liberating freedom that has been brought to us in Christ Jesus that we get to grow in every day. And everything about our life then becomes conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. To look like him, act like him, feel like him. Some of you sit there looking like people in chemistry class. Some of you are taking notes like you're, you know, doing some kind of multivariable equations. Some of you look like my wife when she came and visited genetics class with me one day. It was the most boring thing for her. Because it was like midterms time and it was deep genetics. She's like, do they speak English in here? She kept yawning. Because it was just totally beyond anything that she could connect with. And so in the name of Jesus, I break those things off of you right now. That you somehow are unable to connect with what God is doing and what God is saying, connect with his love for you, real love. Love that captivates your heart so you love him back. And Jesus said, if you love me, you'll obey me. That's the way the kingdom of God works. Isn't that great? We won't have any jails in heaven. The kingdom is not ruled under a theocracy as men would think. It's ruled by relationship. Isn't that cool? Because everybody who's there loves him and is filled with his love and out of love obeys. What will you do, Jesus? I'm not talking about Gandhi's concept of Jesus. I'm talking about Father God's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Roman Catholic concept of Jesus. I'm talking about God the Father's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Pentecostal denomination's concept of Jesus. I'm talking about Father God's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Methodist concept of Jesus. I'm talking about the Father God's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Baptist concept of Jesus. I'm talking about God the Father's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Jewish concept of Jesus. I'm talking about God the Father's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the Buddhist concept of Jesus. I'm talking about God the Father's concept of Jesus. I'm not talking about the philosophical ideologies of men's concept of Jesus. I'm talking about the Bible's concept of Jesus. Satan's biggest lie that he's ever told that more people have believed than any other one is that the Bible has many interpretations. And I can't hardly fathom
how intelligent people can act so clueless. How many mothers did Jesus have? If it has many interpretations. Wonder what her name was. If it has many interpretations. Wonder who his father was. Wonder where he was from. If it has many interpretations. Wonder how many stones David picked up when he was going after Goliath. If it has many interpretations. It's nonsense. It's just lies. No more many interpretations than what you're going to have to be giving you many interpretations on your test in your English class or your math class. Just tell the math teacher, oh, it's got many interpretations. Well, it may have, but I'm going to tell you right now, there's only one that's valid. There's only one that's going to get the check mark. Yet we want to try to play games with God. Nonsense. A true heart says, I know that you're true. I know that you love me. I know that you come to rescue me, come deliver me from destruction. You come to teach me your ways. You come to protect me, provide for me, keep me. Hallelujah. You come to heal me, strengthen me, empower me. Today, I'm kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, and I'm ready to be revealed as a person changed and transformed by the authority that is in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm ready to be revealed as a son of God. I'm ready to be revealed right now because I've got a new heart and a new spirit that happened to me by way of a miracle when the Holy Ghost came upon me. I'm ready to live all the rest of my life in eternity with never sinning or violating the kingdom of God. Well, somebody said, well, you got to die and go to heaven before you can do that. Oh, yeah? So where is the sanctification in the sepulcher? There's no sanctification in the sepulcher. As you live, you die. You die a rebel, forever you'll be a rebel. You live a rebel, you'll die a rebel, and you'll be a rebel. You live obedient, you'll die obedient, forever you'll be obedient. Father promised to change your heart, to change your attitude, to cause us to be endued with the very life of Jesus Christ, to give us a new spirit, to give us his Holy Spirit on the inside of us. There is not a scripture in the Bible that says we know that God realizes that we will sin more or less every day. There's not a scripture in the Bible that says that. There's not a scripture in the Bible that says that God expects us to go ahead and just live a human life and a human existence. He made a new breed of people, a new race. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless, I live, but not me. It's Christ Jesus who lives. The Lord invites every person in this place to come and live in him. And then what's going to happen? You're going to know you're living in him because you're going to have love, 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 love. God, the Father's love. And it isn't going to be some secret love, some love way deep down in your heart that you don't know how to express because you feel all awkward all the time. And you were beat up and rejected as a child, and you just don't know how to express it. You have all this love, but you don't know how to express it. God, the Holy Ghost, will put hands to his love. He'll put expression to his love. He'll put big old kisses to his love. He'll do it. He won't live in the bondage. You won't live in the bondage of your human experience anymore. He'll put joy in your heart. It won't be deep down in your heart that nobody can see it. It'll be seen on your face and on your countenance. You'll wake up with it in the morning. You won't need your coffee first. You won't be oppressed by the prince and the power of the air. People just have people walk around. It's a weight. It's not gravity. It's another force. It's another force. Father's come to deliver us from that sorrow. The redeemed of the Lord have returned and come with singing unto Zion. I'm in Zion now. Zion isn't something that was a little area, geographical area in Israel. It existed far before Israel ever existed. That's why Paul, the apostle, talks about it in Hebrews chapter 12. And he says, we've come unto Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. We right now, we citizens of the kingdom of God. Our conversation is in heaven. We're seated together with him in a heavenly realm. Satan has no power over us. He can't touch us. He can't in any way harm us. We've been given the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. We've been given the whole armor of God because we wrestle not against flesh and blood in this conflict, but against spiritual wickedness. And I'm telling you right now, put spiritual wickedness up against the strength of the Lord and power of his might and tell me, does it have a chance? Let me say it again to you. Put spiritual wickedness up against the strength of the Lord and the power of his might and tell me, does it have a chance? In other words, does Satan have any chance to stand against the purposes of God? Not a chance. Will you come in? Father is inviting you into the kingdom, into his government. He is a government of peace which has no end. The increase of that government has no end. It's an increase. So the government began when? 2,000 years ago, he was coronated. When he was crucified, he died and went to hell. He would think Jesus died and went to heaven. He didn't die and go to heaven. Died and went down into hell. And for 3 days he was there. And he preached to the departed spirits. And he led captivity captive when he came forth, having spoiled principalities and powers and might and dominion, and rose up with the keys of death and hell and the grave. And he ascended up on high, and there was coronated, having received that position in the Father as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and poured out the Holy Ghost as a testimony that he was glorified forever as the King of the government of God. And the scripture says, Isaiah said, and of the increase of his government, there should be no end. So for over 2,000 years, it's been increasing. So it's stronger today than it was 2,000 years ago. It's not less. Hallelujah. 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 The life of God. God is looking for somebody that will come and drink of the water evermore and begin to increase and quit living a human existence and looking like mere men whose activity is limited to the framework of human ability. There are very few people on the earth that has heard the voice of God. Must he go to the stranger? Must this generation go without witness? Must San Diego languish in its darkness because everybody's about their own business and not the master's? Because everyone seeks their own and their own thinking and in their own kingdom? Come on now, let's just turn. Not a lot of effort. God's not looking for a lot of effort from you and I, just looking for us to be willing to be a living sacrifice. Taken by the Holy Ghost. Set upon the altar. Consumed with the fire of God. When the sacrifice is ready, he'll send us fire. He's God who answers by fire. Let Father take hold of your heart right now in Jesus' name. Let him captivate you. The move of God is much bigger than you thought. The working of the power of God is proven by the actions and desires of our heart. Yeah, praise God for the emotional expressions of love and joy. Praise God for the emotional expressions of peace and goodness. But oh, praise God for the conduct of righteousness and purity and godliness and the ability to choose right and to say no to the wrong and yes to the good, to love righteousness and to hate evil. To choose the good and refuse the evil that we may be anointed with the oil of joy. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Hallelujah. I want everybody to stand with me, please. God is calling you. Jesus is calling. He's calling you now. Jesus is calling. He's calling you now. He's calling you now. Same thing. He's calling you now. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Respond to him. Just turn your life over to Jesus. He loves you so much. If you try to figure your way out of your problems, guess what? You'll make them worse. You try to figure your way out of your problems, you'll make them worse. God is just looking for you to surrender your life unto Him, then take control of your life. Today, if you're standing in here and you have sickness and disease in your body, the Lord's here to heal you. He's here to touch you, cleanse you, wash you. God's here to perfect everything that concerns you. Thank you, Jesus. What will you do with Jesus? Somebody said, well, I like Jesus like this. And I believe Jesus like that. No, what will you do with the Jesus of the Bible? John comes with the highest proof. And he said, basically you say, I don't know what all these people are talking about, but let me just tell you, my eyes have seen Him. We have heard Him. We've gazed upon Him, and our hands have handled the word of life. The life was manifested unto us, and we have seen that eternal life and revealed Him unto you. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, I put a blessing of God, the blessing of God upon every person in this place. Every stronghold of Satan, every corrupt thing, everything that belongs to lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, I break it off of you right now. Every mind-blinding spirit in the name of Jesus Christ, I destroy its power right now in Jesus' name. Everything that has held your heart back from complete surrender to the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus, I render it powerless so that you'll be free to love like He loves. You'll be free to joy and rejoice like He joys and rejoices. You'll be free to live like He lives. You'll be free to walk in His goodness, to not be insecure anymore so you can walk in humility. I tell you right now, that takes great security to walk in humility. It takes great security to walk in lowness and meekness. Be filled with the Holy Ghost right now in Jesus' name. Let the power of the Holy Ghost come upon you right now in Jesus' name. Every unclean spirit, I bind you now in Jesus' name. Every unholy thing, I break your power. That every person in this place will have the privilege and the right to make a choice, not bound or entangled with deception. Over the next several weeks, we're going to have some amazing evangelists in the house. Evangelist Richard Moore will be here with us on the 16th of this month. Then Evangelist Tim Hall. Tim was telling me the other day, just over the past couple of months, more than 60,000 people have come into the kingdom. He's in some of the most remote places of the South Pacific and of the world in Asia. Then later on, another week or two out, I think the week of November the 6th, I believe it is, Evangelist Debbie Rich will be with us. Debbie Rich Rister now. So I pray that you'll understand that unless you get into this realm and begin to live in this realm, you'll never grow in it. There are people that come to church, but they don't know how to flow in the Holy Spirit. They don't know how to yield to God, and so they don't grow. They don't grow. It's like a plant set in the shadows and in the shade. They don't grow. But if you'll go ahead and give yourself and surrender to God and yield yourself over to His rulership and His, hallelujah, wonderful Word and Holy Spirit, and begin to just crave the things of God and seek His face, His presence continually. I promise you, God is not a liar. God is not unethical in any way. He's going to do what He promised to do. He'll fill you with heaven. And when you're filled with heaven, all hell goes. He'll fill you with light. And when you're filled with light, no more darkness. No more darkness. He'll fill you with joy. When you got joy to the full, no more sorrow, no more sadness. Only gladness. He'll fill you with love. And it'll come busting out of you like rivers as a pure, pure stream from heaven. Today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your heart. Respond to Him in a heart of total surrender and say, God,
I'm not interested in living another day of my own life. I want your change. I want the change that only you can bring. Oh, you listen to me. I know I said a few political things today, but you must understand, I got a politics going that's bigger than anything that's happening on the ticket right now, because I believe that there will be a great outpouring of the Spirit of the living God, and it doesn't matter if the devil himself is president of the United States. It doesn't matter. Because God is going to pour out His Spirit just like He did in 1773, just like He did when one of my ancestors, Mary Dyer and Ann Hutchinson, was kneeling down in Rhode Island. And it was in, I believe it was 1656. And it was on the day of Pentecost, 1656. No kidding. And they're praying for a Holy Ghost fire. As they were praying, this is history verified. Anybody can go and prove this. As they were praying in Rhode Island on the day of on Pentecost Day in 1656, there came the greatest earthquake that has ever been recorded in that area. Can you imagine what people say? It was just coincidental. I don't believe it was coincidental, because they were praying for Holy Ghost power because of what they were up against, having to deal with the Puritans in the Massachusetts colony. And the place shook, and they estimate that the earthquake was somewhere between a 6 and a 7 on the Richter scale. And there were just a few of them there. And that's how this country and this nation was birthed. And then sprang up by the 1760s, 1770s, a move of God among those like George Whitefield, Jonathan Edwards, John Wesley, and others. And out of that move of God, the Constitution of the United States of America was birthed. Out of that move of God. Out of that move of God. Not out of some genius of political science, but out of that move of God, the Holy Ghost. Then came another great move of the Spirit of God. We call it the Second Great Awakening in the United States of America. Andrew Jackson was president, and he was no saint. You're listening to me. And things were messed up still in the United States, and freedom wasn't ringing loud as it should. And you had to own land to be able to vote. And then the list goes on to be able to participate with any notion of freedom. But in that second great revival, as Charles Finney and other men of God began to move in the power of the Holy Ghost, and men of prayer like Father Nash and others began to cry out to God, the nation was shaken. The nations were shaken as a result. And freedoms were born under Andrew Jackson. It's no coincidence that they were paralleled with the awakenings of the Spirit. There's a third great awakening. There's a third great tsunami, not just a wake. Great flood of the Holy Ghost. And it come through people like me who value not the arm of flesh nor a ticket by some design that has nothing to do with the way this government was ordered by God in the first place. Power is not vested in a man, but in a balance of power that has long been lost. It's about time we start staring at the cross of Jesus so we can get wisdom and insight again. Not be deceived by CNN. And especially the worst of all is Fox. The Fox is spoiled the vine. It's prophetic. It's a fox for sure. It's time God's people have a different kind of mind. Not one polluted by propaganda. Not one distorted by the spin of men.
Not one deceived by all the things that society says. But to begin to hear from heaven the sound of his voice that caused men everywhere to repent. A Holy Ghost wave of conviction that causes men to shake. Thank you, Father. I am so blessed by my heritage, the United States of America, my relatives being the first American martyr, who her blood resulted, very wealthy, great family. Her blood resulted in breaking the power and the stronghold of the Boston, Massachusetts colony in this dominion by the Puritans that tried to legislate what they believed upon Americans. Her blood brought freedom because she was not willing to back down from praying for the sick and unwilling to pay tithes because she was they didn't understand it. You know, Quakers don't understand the blessing and paying and giving tithe, and the Puritans demand it because that's the way they raised funds for the colonies. There was no taxation then. It was, you had to pay tithe. And God brought freedoms by those who would get down on their knees and begin to cry out to God, send Pentecost fire now. Let the shaking of the earth begin. And the same thing that happened there in 1656, hallelujah, will happen here in 2016. If there are people with the same heart and the same faith who just, you know, when they took her up to the gallows that day, she said, yes, I've enjoyed a very wealthy existence, and I have a wonderful family, and I have great holdings, but I have already seen paradise, and I have no desire to linger. On with your work. Ha! Hallelujah. There are people today with such heart, with such conviction, with such certainty about the government of God, because there's a kingdom that we seek whose builder and maker is God. There's a realm of living that we demand, which only the Holy Ghost, having freedom to flow in this land, can produce. No Supreme Court will continue to rule in its tyranny. No imbalance of power unlawfully gained will manipulate the behind the scenes. Freedom's about to ring to the cries of God's people. A great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. A great moving of the Spirit. That doesn't try to change the outward appearance or the outward show of things, but goes and pierces the very heart of the lost. And suddenly, the heart of man overturns Roe versus Wade. The heart of man overturns every unjust law and every unjust dominion. As healing deliverance sweeps the land, the kingdom of God moves in. Father's looking for some troops. On with you work. I've had a glimpse of paradise. I have no longer any desire to linger. I said, I have no desire to linger. I said, I have no desire to linger. Hallelujah. Woohoo! If you want in, if you want in, hear his voice today and harden not your heart. And with total abandonment, thrust yourself into the kingdom. With total abandonment, come, run, and flee from the wrath that is to come. For to be certain of this, it's coming. The wrath is coming. Don't linger. God loves you. He's not going to force you. He's saying, come on into safety. If you don't want to and you want to stay out there, you're welcome to. He doesn't use those words. If you want to linger, he will not force you to. If you want to stay in the darkness, he gave you the right to choose. Come on in. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision to fulfill the desires of the flesh, of that which pure human existence can produce. Let the Spirit of the Lord, he's here right now, let him sweep over you. God the Holy Ghost, he's here right now. Oh, the wonderful strengthening, empowering, changing presence of Jesus here right now. If you've got sickness and disease in your body, I drive it out in Jesus' name. I command it to go. If you just listen and obey and agree with this right now, this is a time for you to come. If you need Jesus, come now. If you're watching by web and you need Jesus, come now to him. You're not in any way held back by distance or by time. If you're watching by YouTube, come now to Jesus. Just wherever you're at, just come. Just come to him right there with your heart. You're in this building right now. Come stand here. The Lord will touch you, change your life. He's provable. That which he said and that which he does is reproducible. What will you do with Jesus? If there's anybody here, you have sickness or disease in your body, when you want to be healed, Christ Jesus, the healer, just as he's the Savior, he's the healer, and of course, to be the Savior, he heals, he saves men from everything, not only spiritual destruction and spiritual disease, but also physical destruction, hallelujah, and physical disease. If there's anybody right now, linger no longer. Just come. Come. Come to Jesus. Come. If you don't have joy, come to Jesus. If you don't have love, come and drink. If you don't have peace, come to Jesus. Ah, tu pare di shitar monke, tu pacchini chi a tu. Oh, si tu lo mondere. If there's no goodness, come to Jesus. If there's no faith, no confidence, come to Jesus. Come to him. He'll give you to drink. He'll give you to drink. Come to Jesus. Hallelujah. Come, come, come to Jesus. Come, come, come right now. He's calling you. He's calling me. He says, come lay hold on eternity. Come, come, come to Jesus. Come, come, he's calling you. Come, come, he's calling you. Come, come, come to Jesus. Let him touch you. Let him fill you. Llénela con Espíritu Santo ahora mismo. Ahora. Ahora. Llénela. Llénela. Filled up right now in Jesus' name. Filled. Filled with heaven's glory. Filled. Father, thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Everything about your life changes today. You sought, you searched out. But I'm going to tell you right now, God searched you out. He's found you. Everything. I break off the lies of religion. I break off the lies of deception. You step in, and your whole family too, into this realm of heaven. It belongs to you. God died at Calvary's cross that you might live. This day you step in, for your ears hear and your heart now. Respond. The fire of God falls on you. The life and the power of God falls on you. The things that tried to destroy you and the deception that has tried to ruin you. There's no more power in Jesus' name. But I see the life-giving flow of heaven for you, for yours, for your family. From this day forward, separated unto God, a holy people. I see the tribes and the kindred and the nations and the tongues and the families of the earth innumerable before the throne of God. And I see you there too. Washed in the blood. Wash. Wash. Washed. Washed in the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this change right here. Father, thank you for blessing baby. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for the fire of the Holy Ghost. Manda kisterina nambo da esheke brudakade estelima kestu. Mareste tereste. In the name of Jesus. In nombre de Jesucristo. Hallelujah. The powerful name of Jesus. To as many as received, he gave to them authority to be the sons of God. Anyone who would believe upon his name. The authority of his name. Jesus. Hallelujah. Joy unspeakable and full of glory is yours. Joy unspeakable and full of glory is yours. Peace that passes understanding, I give it to you now. Fills you right now. Love. Love that goes beyond all knowledge. It's yours. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Strength. Strength. Strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. Strengthened by the power of the living God. Strong. Spontaneously. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Heaven's glory reigning over you. Heaven's glory taking hold of you. Feeling you. Hahana Sheto. Hahana Sheila. Minanea. 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 Fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of Pentecost. Mangea Sinai and Osi. Mangea, it's with your heart you receive it, not your mind and thinking. You don't. People are trapped in their mind of what they've done wrong or what they need. Lord, why don't you just, you got to learn how to receive because you just. In love with Jesus. Sandy, raise your hands towards heaven and watch. So easy to receive. Tis. Touched from heaven. Touch from heaven. Touch from heaven. Touch. Lift up your head. Lift up your head. Lift up your head. Your redemption draws nigh. God's called us not to sorrow and sighing, but to joy and rejoicing. The answer is not found in our begging and pleading, for God has already supplied
but is found in our thanksgiving and praise. There we receive that which He has abundantly supplied. So, the Lord says, rejoice. So He says, rejoice. So He says, rejoice. So he says, rejoice. Sorrow, go from your heart now. Sorrow, go from your life. Sorrow and affliction, go. You just joy now. Just joy now. Let Him anoint you with the oil of joy. Let me just tell you right now. Joy and rejoicing is better than any expression. It's better than any expression. Just go ahead and let Him touch you with His wonderful presence right now. Just let Him touch you. Let Him feel you right now. Let Him feel you. Just receive. Just receive what He has to give you. Baptized. Right now, I take you in the name of Jesus Christ, and I baptize you down into the realms of the things of heaven. Christ Jesus takes you and He baptizes you right down in the realms of the Holy Ghost. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. Touch. Touch. People, I promise you, it's not a struggle. I promise you, receiving something. Have you ever had a big gift and you're going to take it and you hand it to somebody and they're going,
please, can I have that?
No one will do that. They're like, what? Is this for me? Right? Huh? I mean, if you open up the box, you know, and it's like something, you know, a porcelain image of an elephant, it's a little bit of a letdown. But if you open up the box, you're already happy about it. You open up the box, and it's the thing that you wanted more than anything else. That you dreamed of. You couldn't imagine that you could get it. It just gets more exciting. Well, this is what we're trying to do when we come and pray for you. People are groaning and sighing and acting like they've got to, oh, please, God, give it to me finally after such a long time as this. I'm begging you now. He doesn't, no. Without faith, it's impossible to receive from heaven. Just go ahead and receive. Come here now. Come here. Come on, get up. Come back here. Just go ahead. You guys, some people leave the altar too quick. This is your hand towards heaven. I'm just waiting for you to receive. I'm just hovering around. Says the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Lift your hands towards heaven. He's coming with a gift. He's got something for you. So in Jesus' name, receive. Take hold of the gift. Take hold of the gift. Remember this, I can only be a helper of your faith. I cannot have faith for you. I can only be a helper of your faith. I can't receive for you, you got to receive for yourself. Hallelujah. We can hook up with you together. God has anointed us with the Holy Ghost to bring these things of heaven to you, but you've got to receive. So just go ahead now. Just go right on ahead now. Just let the Lord Jesus touch you. Let Him touch you. Just imagine, if you would, you're standing before the throne room of heaven right now. Don't get locked down here on earth. Go ahead, receive right now from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. Thank you, Jesus. say this. Say he fills my mouth with laughter. Ah, ha, 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 ha.
Yes.
So try that, try that. Yeah, just keep practicing that, persevering. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. You go free from everything that would torment you, and you go free from everything that would harass you. In Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Just lift your hands towards heaven and receive it. The healing waters flow in Jesus' name. There it is. Healing to your body. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody stand with me. Just stand with us. Deep calls on the deep. It's all in the rhythm. It's not in the chord. Thank you, Jesus. We love every one of you. We pray God's richest blessing upon your life. More than anything else, grab a hold of the wisdom and the insight that he gives, because if you're willing to obey God and you will respond to his reproofs, he said he will open up your understanding and cause you to and reveal his word to you. He'll open up your understanding and reveal his word to you. The spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ is available to you so that your eyes can be opened and you can really see these things and understand them. He wants to give you an understanding heart. So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, from this day forward, every person standing in this place, watching by the web or YouTube right now, the Spirit of the Lord is upon you right at this very moment to touch your life, to touch every dimension of your life, so that you can begin to walk in the joy and the freedom and the empowerment and the authority that only he gives. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, living God. Thank you, living God. Well, find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Love them. Tell them. And bless them and tell them that you love them. Worship the Lord with your giving. We worship the Lord around here with our giving. Worship him with your giving, your tithes, and with your offerings, and watch what happens. He'll bless you.